Hello friends, this module will cover the fact checking and data verification part of your MOOC. So let's see what is fact checking. Friends, we are receiving information from so many sources these days, like Facebook, Twitter, Google, WhatsApp, and we are in the habit of believing all the information which we are receiving from these sources, but actually it is not so. Most of the forwards which you receive through WhatsApp, or most of the Facebook posts which you receive on various political issues, they are fake actually. And we don't have any formal education to know whether this information is true or false. So in a nutshell, this module is going to cover the basic facts regarding the fact checking and data verification, and at the end we will discuss some online tools which are very useful in finding whether this information is true or false. So in this module you will learn about verification, and this verification of data is an overarching term which includes fact checking for you. Basically it covers the fake news part of it, because if you verify the data online, if you want to check some online facts, then you need to have the verification skills. As you see that you have unlimited data hosting, in many cases it is free now. Availability, manipulation, processing and the distribution by a common man, it is now possible. So when these facilities are available to you free of cost mostly, then sudden explosion of the information takes place, and there are high chances that information is wrong or the compromised. If we discuss the Google doctrine, which states that the technology enabled free flow of information and communication helps mass data to freely flow and spread among increasingly digitized and politicized and agitated people, thus helping in the liberal claims and incites social change. So this is an academic definition of the Google doctrine. It's slightly long, but if you focus on the main part of it, then it says that the free flow of information to digitized, politicized and agitated people will help the democracy in the long run. It is the interpretation of this doctrine. So in this module, we will know a wide framework of fake and unverified news and its various implications on the masses. Every information piece is designed to affect a particular set of audience, and it's not that you are having so much information around and you are not affected by it. So in this module, you will be able to discriminate between a fake information and the real one, like morphing of the photos, doctored videos and malicious tweets on social media posts with the help of specialized tools and techniques. Up till now, we used to believe every information, whether it is in the picture format, whether it is in the video format, and it used to be gospel truth for us, but not anymore, because a researcher should not believe anything in the first place. Every information should be treated as suspicious until it's proven true. Everyone charged with a penal offense has the right to be presumed innocent until proven guilty. This is the common jurisprudence, that fake news or the unverified information is presumed to be reverse. In this case, every information is suspicious and fake unless proven true. So, applying this principle on the daily forwards, daily information received by us, so it is the underlying presumption of the verified information that you should not believe any information which is coming to you in the first place. Coming to the formal definition part of it, the fake news is a term used to represent fabricated news or propaganda, comprising misinformation communicated through traditional media channels like print and television, as well as non-traditional media channels like social media. So this is an academic definition, but I have highlighted a few words here like propaganda, misinformation, print, television, traditional and social media. So these are the main actors in this information, in this fake news. The general motive to spread such news is to mislead the readers or damage the reputation of any entity, or to gain from sensationalism. This is the basic objective of the fake news of the or the unverified information. So it is seen as one of the greatest threat to the democracy, free debate and the Western order. I must clarify here that all these citations, they have been referenced at the end, and many of the thoughts, they have been taken as such from the research papers. So it mainly spreads through social media like WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter and YouTube, as all the platforms offer unlimited and uncensored sharing of the information. So we should be careful that the media, the social media which offers unlimited sharing, uncensored and unedited sharing of the information, that is a big source of the fake news or the unverified news. Mainly due to rumors on WhatsApp, 24 people were killed in the mob lynching incidents in India in 2018, which is 4.5 times more than 2017. You must have read in the newspapers recently that all the mob lynchings which took place recently, it was inspired by some rumors on WhatsApp or on the Facebook. So these are the main sources of mob lynching. So the unverified information or the fake news is not a harmless phenomena. It is very, very dangerous for the public order. And rural areas have very low digital literacy rate. As we all know, that digital literacy rate in rural areas is very less, but very high consumption of broadband and mainly entertainment. Hence, it can be inferred that gullible rural population is more prone to the perils of the fake news. So this whole paragraph, last paragraph, means that the rural areas have less digital education, but very high consumption of the broadband, entertainment, videos kind of thing. And it shows that it infers there can be a relation between the mob lynching incidents and the high consumption of the broadband in the rural areas, because most of the lynching incidents, they have been in the rural areas only. Let's come to a few examples of the fake news. I have repeatedly used the term fake news here, but in the research paradigm, it should be taken as the unverified information. So it applies to every discipline across the board, whether it is mass communication, whether it is education, pharmacy, computer science, etc. Fake news or the unverified information is very, very, it's widespread on the internet. So the Republic TV launched a TV debate on the statement allegedly by Arundhati Roy, stating 70 lakh Indian soldiers cannot defeat Azadi gang in Kashmir. Now, it is a very sensational statement, and whole TV debate was hosted in this. But ultimately, it was found that it was untrue. Somebody just quoted it out of misinformation intention, and it caught the fancy of Republic TV, which hosted a public debate on that. And GNews tweeted that President Ramnath Kovind makes the Twitter debut and earned 30 lakhs followers in 1 hour. Now, this is clearly a fake news, because it is very difficult even for a president to earn 30 lakhs followers in just 1 hour. So But the respected media houses like Zee News tweeted this, and it was retweeted and people liked it, and so many, millions of people were misinformed by this fake news. And a conversion rate card racket unearthed in Kerala, where the conversion rates of girls from different communities to Muslim religion were fixed, as reported by Times Now. Times Now is the television channel of the Times of India, so which is again a very respected media house. And it was found that this information was fake, it was unverified, and these type of news, they have a habit of creating disorder in the society, and they are not to be taken so lightly. And in the coming slides, we will discuss how you can be taken to task by the court of law for spreading the fake news like this. So let's come to some academic part of the fake news, like research on the fake news. So recently, in a BBC poll in 18 countries, it was found that 79% of the respondents, they were worried about what was fake and what was real on the internet. It means it shows some kind of awareness on the part of the internet surfers that what is fake and what is real. In the US, a survey results indicate that the average American viewed at least one fake news story in the months leading up to the 2016 election, which more than 50% of those respondents reporting that they believed the fake news stories. So I'm talking about the Trump election, president election in US. And 50% of the respondents, they are saying that they believed the fake news stories. Now this is it's a very dangerous trend for the democracy. In another BBC research study, the findings emerged that the rising coverage of fake news is there, which is good actually. Definition of fake news is emotionally driven. Like fake news, it affects the emotions of people and they forward it, and there is an emotional reason involved in this. And low scrutiny of information in the digital era, because we are not educated and we are not sensitized to scrutinize every piece of information, which results into the spread of the fake news. And preference for images and minimum text. So people are more they have preference for the fake images than the text. Sharing of fake news being not for the malicious reason. And this survey is in the Indian context, and it says that fake news forwarding it. Is not mainly for the malicious reason, it is mainly because of some ignorant reason. So this survey clearly points out a few facts which repeatedly say tell you the basic drivers of the spread of the fake news. Now we come to the types of the unverified information or the fake news, right? The first one is the satire. Satire, it is created with no intention to cause harm but has potential to fool, like So Sorry Polytune created by India Today Group. So you must have seen it on the television channels. It's very funny, and we daily laugh on these kind of polytunes. So it is also a kind of unverified information of the fake news, so, but it comes in the satire category. The second one is false connection. When headlines, visuals or captions, they don't support the content. This is an example of poor journalism, and it is the main objective to make profit. False connection means when visuals or captions don't support the content, and headlines are also different from what the real text is. That so, if we put false connection between the information pieces, then it is also a form of unverified information or the fake news. Then is misleading content. Misleading use of information to frame an issue or an individual. Objective of this type of content is to create the political influence, partisanship and propaganda. This is mostly done to by sharing the old pictures, old visuals of the incidents, and it is being linked with the current situation, wherein violent scenes from earlier demonstrations, they are being used to portray the current peaceful agitation, and it gives you a misleading kind of context of the story. Then is false content. When genuine content is shared with false contextual information, genuine content is there, the picture is real, it belongs to some earlier incident, but it is deliberately shared with false context. As I just explained in the earlier point, it is very much similar to that, but the context is false. You must keep in mind that. The next word is imposter content. When genuine sources are impersonated with false made-up sources. The recently we had a WhatsApp forward widely circulated, and it said that the BBC survey has found that a particular political party is one of the most corrupt in India, and BBC name is genuine, and but it was there was no survey conducted as such from BBC, so genuine sources were made up to fool people, and it was later clarified by the BBC also. Then next one is manipulated content. When genuine information or the imagery is manipulated to deceive, as with a doctored photo. Like you morph an image, you delete a portion of it, and you add something to the photo through the editing tools. That count is counted in the manipulated content, and we know that many of the images, they are being forwarded like this. The next one is fabricated content. Whole content is 100% false, designed to deceive and to do harm. Whole content, everything is fake. Every part of the photo or the text is, you know, misrepresented. So that comes in the fabricated content. So this all these all types of fake news, they lead to the creation of information disorder concept. So this concept constitutes the idea of disinformation, misinformation, and malinformation. So just to give you a quick snapshot, disinformation means it's a deliberate spread of fake news in order to harm somebody. Actually, we are quite fond of using disinformation, misinformation, and malinformation concepts indiscriminately without even realizing what they really mean. So disinformation is intentional spread of fake news with the intention to harm somebody. In misinformation, it is unintentional spread of fake information, and there is no intention of harming somebody. So our WhatsApp behavior, WhatsApp forward behavior is responsible for this misinformation. Whatever information we receive, we just forward it without applying our mind. So that comes in the misinformation category of it. Then is malinformation, real information to harm somebody strategically, that is minority groups, vulnerable sections and of the society. In malinformation, information is real, it's perfectly fine, verified, but it is strategically used to harm the minority groups. Just for the people's own deriving some benefit out of it. So it is also a kind of fake news. So the whole information disorder can be grouped into these three topics. Now we come to the real part of it, that is the punishment part of the unverified information. Let me tell you that if we are the victim of misinformation, that is if we spread the fake information or unverified information without even knowing the consequences of it, even then we are not immune from the law. Ignorance is no defense in the eyes of the court of law. Let's discuss Indian Penal Code and the fake news. So section 153 and 153A, they are applied to the spread of the spreading of the fake news, like promoting enmity between different groups on grounds of religion, race, place of birth, residence, language, etc. So if we are forwarding any news WhatsApp forward and it is related to some Hindu, Muslim, its party, a particular community, and some language kind of parody we are doing it, we are unknowingly falling into the trap of 153 and 153A section of the IPC. Then comes section 505. It punishes person who spread rumors through their statement to cause public disorder. It's very clear now that IPC has many sections, and it is an overarching legislation which covers every kind of activity, and many sections they are attracted once you spread the fake news. So 505, it is basically, it deals with the fake news, though it was it's a recent phenomena. Fake news is very recent phenomena, but spreading rumors is a crime in section 505, and police can apply this on you. Section 120 is there, that is a criminal conspiracy, that you unknowingly, even if unknowingly you have forwarded something, then you may be tried for the criminal conspiracy. Then section 34 is there, which says that acts done by several persons in furtherance of a common intention. It means that the punishment which was to be given to the whole group now will be may be given to every single person involved in the act. So this is section 34. So I have deliberately included these four or five sections because they have been applied by the police in the fake news spreading in India, and you can go to the internet and you can find yourself that people have applied and courts have given the punishment as per these sections. Let's find out more about the fake news. And the fake news is known to increase during the crisis, elections and other instances of important events. It's not that fake news they are not seasonal, or they occur at a particular time, but there is a trend that during crisis, during elections, during some important events, fake news inflow, it increases. So Malaysia implemented the anti-fake news bill, that is Bill 2018, and a controversial law that deemed publishing and circulation of misleading information as a crime. So it is now the legislation is also very strict on this. Laws are being framed across the world, and very soon it will be a full-fledged field for the researchers and the law enforcing agencies, that is anti-fake news bill or anti-news fake law. So any information present on multiple websites and networks doesn't mean that it's true. A common wisdom tells all of the researchers that this information is present on so many websites, blogs, and so many Facebook posts, it means it is a true. No, it is not, because you will be surprised to know that according to the research, fake news has more chances of being forwarded than the real news. So rather, it is opposite. Means any website information is available on many websites, then it is having more chance of getting as fake. The fake news phenomena is not new, but the ICTs have accelerated the pace. So it is not a new phenomena, it's very old phenomena, but now the information technology tools are there which offer you unlimited sharing and the hosting, so it has increased. It has not ICTs, information and communication technologies, they have not started the fake news, rather they have accelerated the pace. So ignorance in spreading misinformation is of no excuse, because the penal provisions are attracted. As I told you in the last slide, that just by taking this plea that we didn't know that it is a fake information and it will cause so much of the public harm, it will not be in your favor. Court doesn't listen to that. So we should be careful about that. And fake information can exist in text, image or video formats. These are 2-3 formats in which it exists. Now let's come to the action part of it. How to combat fake information. So we must bear in mind that there is no single method. Technology is only support, but the human cognition and traditional methods, of course, of cross-verification are more important. Yeah, because it is a common established wisdom that technology cannot do everything, and we have to rely ultimately on traditional skills to verify that information. There are so many different aspects of a particular information. Technology will be helpful up to a certain points only. Beyond that, our local knowledge or the traditional knowledge about that really matters. Anything revolutionary or shocking or too sensational information has very high chances of being fake. Like if you are receiving any forward on WhatsApp or Twitter or on Facebook, and the information, the news is so revolutionary, like it's so shocking that you did not know it earlier about any political party, about any political person, about anything. So just your safety valve should activate inside that it may be a fake news. If it is so sensational and so revolutionary, why did not the traditional media, which is more credible, which printed it? They did not print it. So that gap is there. So that is our traditional knowledge, that we should understand that it is has a high chances of being fake. And in the last, local knowledge of the area, culture, etc. are the added assets for the verification. As I already explained, local knowledge is always preferable over the technological knowledge as far as verification is concerned. Now we go to the practical part of it.
So let us have a practical demonstration of the fact-checking tools. Fact-checking can be done for three formats. First is the text, second is photo, third is the video. So all the information, it comes in one of these three formats. Let's start with the text. If somebody has sent you this text and you want to verify whether it is right or wrong, then we have to go to the Google and let's copy this first. We will paste this here in the double quotes and enter. So it is telling us that this sentence is appearing in the following websites as such, and it is showing seven results. Yeah. Like it is available on Hindu.com 6 hours ago. Lok Sabha was adjourned for the day, and this is the para which was taken. Yeah, this para was taken. So the only method is to put it in the double quotes and then put it in the Google and enter. It will show the similarities. For verifying the text, or other Google commands are also helpful. For example, if somebody claims that it belongs to a particular website, then you can enter that site command, which is discussed in the effective googling module, like name of the website, and then enter the information or the text in the double quotes, and then search. So press enter. If it is there, it will show up in the Google, and you can be sure of. So we come to photo verification. Daily we see so many photos on WhatsApp which are being sent to us by the people, and we are not sure of the credentials of the photo, whether it is fake or real. So the simplest method is you open images.google.com and do a reverse searching, reverse image searching. So this is the website. You press this camera icon, upload an image. So if the image which is to be verified is available on your computer, then you can upload that image, and Google will tell you the best guess for this image or the visually similar images. Now see, this photo is of Dalai Lama ji and Gandhi ji. It is in circulation for the last so many years, and it claims that Dalai Lama met Gandhi ji when Dalai Lama was a child. So it was circulated widely, but when it was entered in Google images, then it is telling that fake news police. It is a fake photograph, and it was debunked by so many websites. So this way you can upload the image to the Google images, and it will show the best result of it. Just by simply entering and looking at the result may not serve the purpose. Sometimes you have to go through the results itself. Second part of the result, third part, and you have to verify, cross verify. And it is reverse, this is Google reverse image search, and it is using Google server only. But if some this photo is present on the website, for example, if you open the image here, so it is now available on the web. So you don't have to download it then upload on the Google. You can simply right click, and here you will see a reverse image icon and all search engine. So it will not be displayed unless you download a Google Chrome extension which is known as RevEye. For example, RevEye extension, if you search on the Google, then it will be displayed like this, and it can be pasted on to the Chrome, and once it is installed, then it will be displayed here like this. You can close this then, and you can come back to the image. And now if you right click, then this reverse image search icon will be there, and this image will be searched by Google search, Bing search, Yandex, TinEye, and Baidu. Yandex is a Russian search engine, Russian photo search engine, and Baidu is Chinese, because Google is banned in China, so it will not be able to tell you the all the images which are in another country. So instead of searching through Google only, it is better to use this extension and click all search engines. and see. It will be searched by all these search engines. So you have to go to these images and find out what is the truth. Then it is very important to go to the actual version of this image. The story about this fake photo is that it is a combination of two photos, like Gandhiji's image was taken from some photograph and this child's photo was taken from some another photograph, and they were merged by using the image editing software. So sometimes in order to verify the things, you have to use a clipper tool, and you can take an image of this and save. Similarly, you can clip the image of Gandhiji's, upload both the images, what were the original images. So this way you can find out the truth behind the photograph. While quickly coming to the video verification part of it, if you receive some video from a friend on WhatsApp, then it is always advisable to use the web version of WhatsApp. We know that the WhatsApp can be operated on the desktop itself, so it is advisable to download the video here. For example, so WhatsApp images and the videos can be downloaded here by using the web version of it. And for the video verification, we would install a extension which is known as InVid, Google Chrome extension. InVid. So install it on Chrome and it will be visible like this here. Okay, we go to the YouTube. If we want to find out whether the video is real or fake, so what we will do is we will take the URL of this video and copy this, and we will open InVid extension here. It will tell open InVid, and here you can copy and paste a YouTube or Facebook URL. So Facebook videos can also be fact checked. So you enter that and you press submit. So it will first display the information about the video. The most important was the uploading time. So you have to convert it to the local time, that is Indian time. And then all these video frames, they have been separated here. Choose the one which is having most obvious objects in the background, the maximum number of objects in the background. Like this one is having maximum number of objects, that is greenery also, some animals also. And you can again click Google reverse image search and it will again search the photo frame of this video and you can explore that further. For watching different keyframes, you can use this keyframe icon. For the video part of it, you can use it, use this function magnifier, which will pause the which will magnify a particular area of the photograph. So these were a few tools for fact checking, and rest of it they are explained in the theory part of it. And I must repeat again that technological tools, they have limitations, but the indigenous knowledge, it will be more helpful in fact checking. Thank you so much.
And in the last, we need to conduct the social audit of the uploader, the person who has uploaded the information. It applies more in case of the information uploaded on the social websites. So it is very, very important to know about the person who has uploaded. Sometimes it gives you vital links. So you should build a social profile of the suspicious uploader as to verify whether his or her credentials are genuine or not. So look at the friend lists, family connections, prominent logs, variation and in the quality of uploads. I mean, those uploads will be poor in quality in most of the times, and there would be variation in that. Topics of uploads can also give you very vital clues, and subliminal patterns, the patterns which are not visible through the common understanding. Financial or political motivations and the types of posts shared earlier also, in order to build a profile which can tell us many things. So what are the financial motivations of that person of sharing the information? What is the earlier history of that person? How much he has shared? What type of posts he has shared? So it can give you more information about the uploader, which you can use to verify your information. Thank you so much.